Hey guys, and good morning. I speak with you about the click model today. And let's start. So you wrote a very cool tool with lots of capabilities, and you feel so proud about it. It is working great, and your colleague is willing to use it. Then you are starting to hear phrases like, how this stuff works? Where is the help message? How should passive parameter to look like? Why there is no auto-completion? Suddenly, you realize that you hadn't invested enough time in order to create nice CLI. I assume that all of you faced such issues in the past. In my talk, I will speak about quick and robust solution that will take CLI creation headache from you. My name is Ilya Meirovich. I am Central CIOps developer from Red Hat, and I will speak with you about how we can create CLI and Qlik with Qlik. So why do we need CLI? It's much easier to use tool that provides help messages, validates parameters, and has auto-completion options, rather to dig inside source code in order to understand how this tool works. CLI that provides such capabilities allows faster adaptation of tools both by manual and automation users. So why usually we meet non-user-friendly CLIs? Here's a paradox. Why even experienced engineers tend to produce non-user-friendly CLIs when they are aware about CLI importance? And I think that the answer is that CLI is the last thing to be developed. So it is written in a quick manner with a lot of TBDs that will be never implemented in future. Usually, expansion and maintenance of such CLI is at least annoying. I assume that you're familiar with Kausink tool, and when you're starting to play with it, you usually stuck into command line, and then you need to press Ctrl-C in order to escape back to shell. Then you're trying to read its help message. That doesn't help. Finally, after Googling in Stack Overflow, or maybe hoping for to see some example in mine page, you manage to run the Kausink tool. And let's take a look on widely used CLI approaches. Let's take a look how we can implement a simple Qlik tool in Python. First of all, direct usage of command line parameters. You wrote some cool stuff, you want to test it. Mostly, this is the first step that you are doing. You are just trying to pass command line parameters and try and debug your software with those parameters. So why we are doing this is our first step in CLI creation. It's very easy. No need for additional code. Debugging is very fast. Why we cannot continue with such CLI? It's not user-friendly at all. We need to remember parameters, options, order, no help message, no parameters validation. We want something much more robust. And usually, next step is getOpt, especially for C programmers. GetOpt allows short long option names and CLI parameters parsing according to the predefined options. In small programs, it is useful and allows parameters parsing without any black magic. However, if we want to make our CLI much more useful, we will end up in if-else hell. We need to write a lot of logic for parameters parsing, and GetOpt approach is not scalable. So next thing is argparse. According to Python documentation, it is the recommended command line parsing module in the Python standard library. Argparse allows a lot of functionality. It is a very robust module. However, it has some serious disadvantages. It has built-in magic behavior to guess if something is an argument or an option. And it causes problems with dealing with incomplete command lines, as it is not possible to know without having a full understanding of the command line how the parser is going to behave. It's very bad behavior. You should understand the whole behavior in order to understand how to work with command line. Argparse currently doesn't support disabling of interspersed arguments. In some cases, it makes CLI nesting very, very hard. And this is another thing. You don't have inbox support for bash completion argparse. And in order to build CLI, you want bash completion. And here comes Qlik. Click is for command line interface creation kit. And let's take a look on Click versus CSRV. Click addresses the need for less code and binding between CLI and functional code. That tempts many developers to use CSRV approach at the beginning of CLI development. With Click, you can skip CSRV step in CLI development and provide a nice and friendly CLI very quickly. So let's take a look on the Click syntaxes. So you have Click command decorator that creates new command and uses decorated function as a callback. Then you can see that you have a Click option. You see here option for name, command option, help expansion, and the Click option attached an option to the command. As you can see, with a little amount of code and effort, we can create a nice and expandable CLI from scratch. You can compare now CSRV versus Click. You can see the output of help with Click. It's much more readable. Amount of code is pretty similar. And there is additional nice single click. The doc string of the decorated function is your help message. In this example, I didn't put any doc string inside Greeter. If there was some doc string, it will be between usage and option in the options in the help message. And let's take a look on Click versus ArcParse. Click allows much more readable code that could be expanded easily than ArcParse code. Instead of writing parsers and remember parser names and parser code location, we can decorate our code and create nice nested CLI with less code and much more readability. In this case, we will decorate Greeter with group decorator and then decorate subcommands with Greeter command decorator that was created by Click from Greeter function. Then we attach an argument to subcommand. As you can see, less amount of code, and you see the direct binding between the CLI and between the function. So why Click? As you can see from these examples, Click code is much more readable than other CLI code. When it provides similar and in some cases better end user experience. Critics of Click usually criticize close relation between CLI and backend code because when you are using Click, you usually decorate functional code. On the next slides, I will show how we can create nested CLI with Click that will be backend independent. So let's take a look on the task like this. You have a lot of scripts. You want to create a single powerful CLI for all your CI scripts. And you want to have bash completion. You want to have nested help messages. You want it to be easy to maintain and to expand. And finally, you want it to have backend independent. So if you want to switch to another tool in future on the backend side, you can do it easily. And in this example, we'll look on this CLI outline. We will have some tool, side tool, sort of CLI, with options that it can accept. Then we have command with options for this command, and then opcode with options for this opcode. For example, if you want to set up or tear down Jenkins slave and Jenkins. Jenkins is a continuous integration system, and Jenkins slaves or Jenkins nodes are machines that are used in order to run Jenkins tasks. So for example, we have CI tool, some options, Jenkins slave, some options, setup teardown, it could be also something with testbed or with Jenkins job builder, a lot of stuff. This is a CLI entry point. In order to allow expandable nested CLI, I need to centralize the registration logic. I have put this logic inside CLI meta class that instantiates base CLI class. All CLI modules in this example will inherit from base CLI. And base CLI, this is our first import after Click import. Yesterday, my colleague Sim Zaks already explained about metaclasses and decorators in his wonderful lecture. In this example, you will see how we can use metaclass in order to provide nice interface and perform all registration logic in one place. So in the beginning of the module are extension imports. You can see here, for example, CLI interfaces Jenkins slave and Jenkins master. No QA argument is to make a pilot happy. Extensions inherit from base CLI class. And CLI meta collects extensions formation and store it. CLI meta also performs CLI commands registration. So actually, by the time of the instantiation of CLI class, all information about CLI extensions has been collected, and CLI subgroups already has been filled with commands. CLI class itself contains a subgroup register parameter that is populated with subgroup references by CLI meta. I will explain about CLI meta and extensions later. And CLI class also contains two methods. CLI method is the root of the whole CLI. It's decorated by click group decorator that creates a new group. We have also click option decorator that adds project default option. This is an example for CLI wide option. Finally, we use base CLI context decorator that passes innermost context dictionary. It allows us to pass in user information derived from CLI options in all nested levels. And the CLI methods are CTX, that is context that received from base CLI context decorator. And we have KWRs. This is the way to pass all CLI parameters from click to our click function. And thus you can, in this example, CLI function is simple. It just updates the configuration dictionary with CLI info. We can process here additional, we have process here CLI data, we can call here a backend function, we can do a lot of stuff here, it's just an example. Register CLI class method, this is the second function, it's responsible for control logic. It called in CLI meta during CLI class instantiation, and it registering all CLI extensions and click group object created by CLI method. It is done by, if you can see in register CLI, you have CLS CLI add command. It's click group add command function. And with this function, you can add commands of group to your group. So basically, if you take a look at this file, at the beginning, you have all the imports. When the imports are done, all the information about CLS subgroups already collected. When CLI, class instantiated. All this information put inside CLI class. In this way, our CLI root is aware about all its extensions. Finally, we have CLI entry point in our main, it's CLI CLI. And let's take a look on the CLI extension. I have removed various option stuff in order to concentrate on the core. Actually, in order to add CLI extension, we need to inherit from base CLI. And we need to add following class parameters. You have subgroup name, they should put there, for example, you can put there our subgroup name. Subgroup commands will contain a list of the commands for the subgroup. Then we simply implement our group and our commands in the click way. And not forget to add context decorator that will be responsible for passing a context dictionary between CLI between also inside CLI. As you can see, all registration logic is hidden. Base CLI is translated by CLI meta, and it contains the two methods and one parameter. Context settings. This is the click parameter, the parameter that we can pass to click in order to add some system-wide option. In this example, we enhance clicks help in clicks. You don't have minus H flag by default. You have minus minus help. If you want minus H, you should specify it. And finally, you have the context method. Context method actually wraps clicks make pass decorator that can create with the class that you pass to it. The context class that you can move information without it inside CLI. And we have register CLI, that is class method that will be called in CLI meta, that actually is to perform all the registration logic in childs of this class. And it, as you could see before, it was overridden in my CLI because the logic is different there. So finally, our control unit, CLI meta. What happens in CLI meta? During class instantiation, we have the next logic. We can collect our subgroups information. We really need context in the base CLI. So this way, we have our context dictionary, and we have all the information from subgroups. At the end, we'll pass the subgroups registry to main CLI. And CLI meta, in its new method, will also launch CLI subgroup registration. So as you can see, all the logic contained in one place. And it makes other CLI structure more simpler, and you can, it makes expansion of CLI simpler, because the person that should implement CLI extension shouldn't be aware about all control logic. He should just only new click. Regards context, just simple object that contains configuration dictionary. It could be could put much more logic here. It's as I thought, it's just an example of how we can do it. So setup.py. In order to have auto completion, we need to use setup.py. It's click requirement. We should define our Py models here, and we should define entry point for CLI. As you can see, it's CI minus 2. And here is an ugly bash completion hack. I just wanted to put it here in order to show how we can add bash completion easily. So in bash completion, you see that just put the source of CI2, the CI2 that was defined as CLI entry point, and it's working. So let's see the user experience, because till now it was code. So we have CI2. As you can see here inside, CI2 help message, it's a doc string of the main CLI method. You have the help. You have auto completion. As you can see, CI2 Jenkins tab, Jenkins master, Jenkins slave. You have a nested help. If you want to try to run CI2 Jenkins slave setup, it will report an error and tell you that there is a missing option. And if you want to understand what happens, you press minus H, and you see, okay, Jenkins master URL, it's a required option. In click, you have a flags for required options. Also, in click, you can define the type of the options, as here before. You have topology options, SSH key file option was defined as path, you have text options. And finally, because there is no backend binding, just printed the configuration dictionary that contain default values, so uninitialized parameters that initialize with none, and contains our Jenkins master URL. If you can summarize this example, as you can see, we can create nested expandable CLI with Qlik. CLI remains readable and can be expanded by following predefined pattern and rules. For in this example, developer should inherit from base CLI, define CLI group and its commands, and implement it. Finally, he needs to add CLI extension as an import in main CLI in order that all the registration logic will work. So such way CLI could be expanded quickly, and if you have some changes in front-end or back-end, they could be quickly applied. About Qlik, so from developer point of view, you have very readable and extendable code. Function help messages are CLI help messages. Function parameters could be CLI parameters if you want. Nesting is very easy, and there is no black magic. Bash completion is built in. And from user point of view, you have formatted help messages, bash completion, expected and predicted behavior. So I have put here some useful links. Qlik is a mature module. It's I checked its statistic yesterday. It has about 200,000 downloads last month, and it's in a stable state. Its latest version is 6.5, I think. I used this blog about comparing realpython.com in order to prepare this presentation. And finally, you can find my example in my GitHub. So the question is, how do you compare docopt versus Qlik? So first, I didn't use having docopt, I just played with it a little bit. Okay, so docopt, it's a very powerful tool, but it's in its earlier versions, it's not even its 1.0 version, it's in earlier versions. And if I remember correct, docopt based on parsing, you prepare some help message and it parses it. So this is it lacks some Qlik features, and I think this is the different model, because in Qlik you are using a programmatic model. You just add decorator, or if you want, you can use inheritance and stuff like this. And in docopt, you write some help message, and it will be parsed. So I think there are different approaches, and I read a lot of good stuff about DocOpt, but from the reviews, from the blogs, my impression was that it has still a long way to go. So the question was if I had tried it under Windows. I don't know if it's lucky or unfortunately, but not. I'm working on Red Hat. By the way, maybe now Windows, in the last update with Windows 10, that you will have command line that actually based on Ubuntu, it will work. So it should work in Windows according to the blogs. I didn't try it. One questions? Okay, so thank you guys.